have an upcoming assignment for this class on doing a micro, meso, macro intervention. And this is a very important perspective that we use in social work. You may have heard in 171, social workers view the person in the environment, the person in the environment. It's called PI for short. Or it can also be called the ecological model. This is covering your book in chapters 1 and chapters 3. But for this assignment and the activity that we're going to do in class right now to prepare you for that assignment, this more specifically is gone over in pages 79 through 89 in your book. Read those thoroughly and you'll be well prepared to do this assignment. So the micro level that we look at is the person, the client's personality, their motivations, their affect, meaning their emotional presentation, how they come across to the personal, and other personal attributes. Can you think of any other personal attributes that might be in this micro area? Like, we get very quiet when we're being filmed, huh? Go ahead, Sandy. That would be more, the community would be more the meso-mezzo level, right? The person, then the family, the community, and then the larger culture and society. Everything grows out from the individual. So at the individual level, some of the personal attributes, Dulce? Their strengths, yes, their strengths. The intrinsic qualities that they have that cannot be taken away from them, such as a good sense of humor, such as being intelligent, such as being very adaptable, such as being warm and friendly, things like that, you know, that just kind of make up the person's personality and other traits that they might have. It's gone over more in the book. All right, the meso level is the context immediately surrounding the client, family, church, group, close friends, and work group. So that's what you were alluding to, Sandy. And then is the larger society's characteristics and the way the client experiences these. For example, the political system, social stratification, educational system, the economy, things that are systematic that affect the person in their environment. And here's a little framework where you can kind of see those in. Here's the person. Here's the, we call it the ecosystem, but it's the meso system. The community, mass media, health agencies, school. And then the macro is the economic, society, nationality, culture, political system. I want to go over an example with you that helps you from a social work perspective understand it a little bit better. And that is childhood obesity. So childhood obesity, as you may know, is rampant in our society with our standard American diet and lifestyle affecting a lot of children. Children are now being diagnosed with type 2 diabetes in preschool. And some teenagers are even having neuropathy by the early teen years, which is something that's been unheard of until just recently. That's usually for later on in life. So I have one of my interns that I had about 10 years ago. She works at Phoenix Children's Hospital where they have a behavioral developmental eating program as well there. And she deals with a lot of childhood obesity. And do you think that, so this is the childhood obesity, it's the child, that's the micro, right? But do you think that we're gonna be very effective if we just work with the child? No, no, we have to take into consideration the larger systems that impact the child, right? So the child herself, her own behaviors, and what, if she's sedentary, does she get any physical activity? And what about her dietary intake? Those are all important things to look at the individual level of that child. We can work with her in that way. But we need to go broader as a social worker. We would not be doing our person in the environment intervention if we didn't go broader. So we want to look at parenting styles and family characteristics as well, such as the parents' weight status, such as their own TV viewing and sedentary activities. encouragement of activities? Is it valued in their family? Do they understand the need for that? Their own dietary intake, their nutritional knowledge, and the foods available in the home. And say this family is on SNAP, the food stamps program, and they only receive $160 per person per month to buy food. Do you think that that has an impact as well? Why is that? You can't be very healthy eating ramen noodles, right? Or other refined foods. You're not going to be buying fresh fruits and vegetables and organic foods that we know are healthy and promote well-being and healthy weight, et cetera. But we also have to look at the community as well and the demographics involved. So ethnicity, why is it important to factor that in, ethnicity? Mm-hmm.
Because different foods are available in different cultures. Like Mexican food has a lot of fat in it. And so if you're deep frying everything and not getting a lot of exercise, you're going to...
Right. So there's the cultural perspective where certain foods are valued and they're customary. And there's also the genetic predispositions of each ethnicity and culture as well that are involved. And we would want to take that into consideration. What about school lunch programs? Why should we be thinking about the Department of Agriculture, which is who funds our school lunch programs? Why is that important? Because usually they don't get good lunches, right? I think we spend about 99 cents per lunch for a kid. What is it? Oh, a place at the table?
Yeah.
It was 15 cents? Well, it was very low, not high enough, for definitely, to provide high-quality food. And, you know, the school lunch programs consider the sauce on pizza to be a vegetable. Ketchup is a vegetable. Is it a vegetable?
No,
probably not a vegetable, right? So we want to look at the school lunch programs and how they're funded. That has an influence on this child, this individual child. What about work demands? If the parent doesn't come home until 8 o'clock at night and the child is home by themselves and they're eating to nurture themselves or comfort themselves because they're not getting enough nurturance in the home because the parent just has to work and these are the hours that they're working, that makes a difference as well. Accessibility to recreational facilities. I worked in a school district where no one went outside after school to play in the park because it was dangerous to play in the park, and if they even had a park. So that matters, is the crime and safety in the area is going to affect childhood obesity, right? Accessibility of convenience foods and restaurants. In that movie that you referred to, A Place at the Table, it also mentions food deserts. Remember food deserts? Where within a certain mile radius, there are no grocery stores. And the people that live in that area are predominantly poor, and they don't have transportation. And they have children. And they have to take a public transportation to go to a good grocery store to buy food that's healthy and at a decent price. So instead, they end up using Circle K, 7-Elevens, convenience stores, Quick Trip, instead to buy their food. And what kind of food do you get there?
Junk.
Junk food, predominantly. Not the type of food that would promote health, but would promote childhood obesity.
Mm-hmm. And the healthier food that's available in those places is going to be marked up really high. So an apple's going to cost $1 as opposed to going to a grocery store where you can get 4 apples for $1.
Yes. Can you hear her? Should I repeat that? That's right. The healthy food in those places is going to cost more money. So you'll pay $1 for an apple, where if you went to a grocery store, you might be able to get 6 apples for $1, you know, et cetera. Neighborhood safety, we already went through that. The school physical education programs, a lot of districts are doing away with PE programs, right? They just don't have the funding. Does that contribute to childhood obesity? Yes, you get it. And then the socioeconomic status. Certainly, if you have more money, you can buy that healthy, wholesome, fresh, organic food, even have it delivered to your home, and maybe even prepared for your children. But the lower the socioeconomic status, the more we see issues with health and obesity. So we want to take all of this into consideration as we work with the person in their environment. And that's what social workers do. So the activity that we're going to do here in class is we're going to turn to page 90. And we're going to read the case study of Florence. Then I'm going to have you break into small groups at your table. And you're going to identify at least three of Florence's strengths, right? Because that's what we do as social workers. We identify strengths first, and we use those strengths to intervene with the problem. And then I want you to identify the problem in these various levels of intervention, the micro, the meso, and the macro. So we read the case of Florence. That's a difficult case, huh? Difficult life. That she's been handed a very challenging situation that she grew up in and then now lives in as an adult woman, right? So we may look at this case as we may look at many of our clients and think, strengths? What strengths? I see a lot of problems. But it's really important for us to identify strengths first and foremost. Like Dulcie was saying as I was walking around, I wouldn't want someone interviewing me and looking for my weaknesses, you know, that would feel awful. That would feel terrible. So it feels better to look for what's right, what's good, what they have that we can work with, than to look for what is wrong, character flaws or anything like that. So strengths. So what did you guys come up with? What strength?
She's strong for everything.
Strong, yes, from what she's been through. So I hear resilience. Yes. You know, that's what resilience is that even in the most difficult situations, someone has the ability to overcome. So resilience, put that down. Okay, how about you guys? What did you come up with besides that?
We found that she had sought resources, so she was on welfare, so it means that she found a way to get resources at some point.
So she's resourceful, and she has some resources, yes. Navigating through the welfare system is not easy. It weeds out a lot of people. A lot of people say, oh, this is too much work. Forget it. I'm not going to receive any assistance. But she did, so we want to draw upon that. Mm-hmm. How about you guys?
She had a sense of responsibility. She wanted, working on the farm, she took
Yeah, she is used to working hard. She, from a very young age, she has been responsible and hardworking. And how do we see that playing out now as an adult? What was something in the case that made us feel like she still is responsible and hardworking? How she kept her house, yes. Her house was worn, but very immaculate, right? So she is also clean and organized, right? All right, how about this back table right here?
Okay, another one I just noticed was that she's very loving and like compassionate and forgiving because she wants to talk to her family, and the reason why she wants to fight is for like her daughter.
I am so glad that you identified this strength because I think that's one of the strongest that we will use. How do we know that she's loving and that she still cares? What in the case tells us that?
Because she was saying that she's scared of work, she's scared to go outside and do all this, but she still went and tried to get her daughter back to what she could do, and she was saying how she hasn't talked to her family, she would love to, and they're so
mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, so she's open, right? And when the police officers came to tell her that her husband had died, she wept, she could cry, she could express emotion still. A lot of people in this kind of situation with such a difficult life would harden up and they would cut off their emotions and their heart. But she doesn't appear that way. She appears like she still is a warm, loving person, you know? So that's a lot to work with that we have, that we'll use that. And then was there anything else that we missed, you guys, at the back table?
She enjoys socializing.
She likes to socialize, yeah. So what does that tell us as the social worker in this situation?
issue.
She likes people. She'll be open to us coming there and connecting with her because she really enjoys that, right? So these are some really huge strengths that we're going to use to deal with her problems. And her problems are significant, right? So at the micro level, what did we come up with? What? Just call them out.
Her strengths.
Oh, uneducated?
Uneducated. All right.
She has a little self-worth.
Low self-worth. What else?
Lack of affection.
Lack of affection? Mm-hmm. How do you say she has lack of affection?
Because she felt like her parents didn't like her and her aunt.
So she feels unloved, yeah. Right? Unloved. What else?
Her own parenting practices.
Parenting. Really lacks any kind of parenting skills, right? But there's one really huge, big one. Big, big, big at the individual level that we haven't identified. What is that? Fear. Fear, yeah, but... Lack of support, that's more a little more MISO. Yeah.
She's depressed.
She's depressed. But not only is she depressed, she's also grieving, right? She may have been depressed and then was hit with grief and loss, and that complicates the depression, right? So depression and grief. All right, very good. So, you're the social worker and you identify all these problems. You do not want to overwhelm her, right? If we could come up with one intervention that would help identify and meet the needs of these problems, what might that one intervention be? What would be the biggest bang for our buck and our time and our energy if we referred her to what?
I would get her into a support group of other people like her.
Support group might be good. Yes, that's in the realm of appropriate. The support group. What else?
Maybe try to get her back to school.
Into school, that would be a good one as well.
Maybe counseling.
Counseling. All right. Of those, support group. What was the other one? School or counseling. Of those, how many think sending her to a support group would be the best referral for her? Yeah. Okay, how many think school, getting her in school would be the best? How many think counseling would be the best? And I would agree. Yes, I would agree. Counseling would be the best, most appropriate intervention at the micro level. Why is that?
Mm-hmm. Isn't it because I feel like putting her in a support group would be a little bit too much for her to handle since she's been isolated for so long, one-on-one, talking just about her would help her out more than just feeling judged by a group of other people. And then schooling, I feel like she can't do anything until she gets herself, like, good, in a good place.
Yeah. Her confidence in herself is so low, right? Her self-esteem and everything like that. She needs that one-on-one kind of bond and support to even go and do any of these things. But that's definitely on the radar. We definitely want to keep that on the radar. There will be a time when that is a good. And there's a hand up over here.
Also, the one-on-one, I think something that's like it's like the self-worth issues and the parenting issues and the self-esteem and the depression. It can just be one-on-one with somebody helping her realize those within herself before she can go on to support.
Yes. Right, you have to have it inside of yourself, right, first. And that relationship, that kind of therapeutic rapport and relationship would help her to identify that, right? Because in the therapeutic relationship, we're going to make her aware of all of this. We're going to say, you know, Florence, you are dealing with a lot right now. I don't know how you're doing it, but you are a very strong person. And, you know, throughout your life, no matter what difficulty has come along, you have shown resilience. You have. Somehow, some way, here you are, you know. And I find you to be very resourceful, really. I mean, how did you navigate the child welfare, the welfare system? That is a lot. A lot of people would have just given up, but you didn't, Florence. You know, how did you do that? We would draw out her strengths, right, and remind her of these qualities about herself. You know, you're very resourceful. You're a hard worker. She will know, you know, you're such a clean, organized person. Oh my gosh, there's got to be a business for you in doing that, going into people's room and helping them homes and decluttering, you know. And she will begin to know that she is really a loving and a forgiving person. And that would feel good to just be able to talk with someone and not be so isolated. And it will remind her of all her strengths, because many of our clients, when they come to us, they don't, if you ask them, what are your strengths? They do not know what to say, honestly. So through the therapeutic relationship, we will help her to own her strengths, all right? So, at the MISO, what did we come up with at the MISO? We're gonna start with you guys. Neighbors, yeah. Very difficult relationship with the neighbors, doesn't even get that kind of support. What else is back here, right here?
Just to like her daughter, mm-hmm. and maybe like the agency she's visited, like those people, I wouldn't really know if I would put them there. I feel like it's like the closest thing she has.
Yeah.
Either, like, the
right, her daughter is not in her home, and yeah. you know, we don't even know if has she started even visiting with her? Yeah, we don't even know. So that's an issue in her connection. I think she really loves her daughter, but all she knows is abusive parenting, right? And then what else here in the MISO?
Dave.
What is it? Dave's death, and family. No relationship with her family. So what intervention, taking these into consideration, might we want to use to hook her up to some sort of support that way, identifying the MISO issues for her? Or is counseling going to do it? You know, do we want to start there and let her do one thing and do it well?
Yeah.
I think so, too. I think counseling could help her identify, you know, I think maybe go over and bake some cookies for your neighbors and try to mend those relationships, you know. And talking about Dave's death and talking about family and how to reunite with him, things like that would be a great thing to do. So counseling here as well. All right, this is always the hardest one. This is the most challenging, we might get stuck. But the macro, so the policies, the culture, the society, the systems, the influences that impact families, what can you think of at that level?
She lives in a rural area and doesn't know how to get to who will provide the parenting classes for her.
Yeah. The needs of a rural area are often overlooked with programs, legislation, funding. It's very, very different, right? So we could address that by, you know, talking to a legislator in that rural area and just making it known that we have families that are languishing, children in the foster care system, because we don't have these resources. Maybe we could get Wi-Fi into these areas and do the parent training programs on the computer, you know, because there's some rural areas that don't even have internet access because they're so remote. But these are issues, larger issues that affect people like Florence that we as a social worker would be looking at. Okay? What else?
Well, it just said that she was like next in line on the single mother's list to be getting a job, but they can't help, like she's not coming in.
So the lack of jobs in the rural areas is another issue, right? The economy and the waiting list, things like that. If we have a waiting list, maybe we need to create more jobs somehow, some way. And the legislator that's elected from that area, someone that we would want to make that known to. They don't know unless we let them know. Oh, and what else here at the macro level?
Could our education be something?
Education. And there's actually two pieces to this education thing. First of all, how was she allowed to drop out at age 13 from school? Isn't that against the law? It is here in Arizona, you have to be 16. But was there a school social worker at the school that she was at? Was there a resource officer or a truancy officer? Why didn't someone recognize, oh my God, this 13-year-old girl is not coming to school any longer, and you know, what kind of a chance does she have in life if she drops out at 13? We need to engage her and bring her back in, and we need to have a talk with the parents, right? But then the second piece of it is that, like in the hospital here in Arizona, when a young woman has a child, or even an older woman has a child, they do a screening, and on that screening, they ask how they were parented as a child, what kind of supports they have available to them. They do an assessment. And Florence would rate very high at risk for child abuse and neglect of her own child. We know that, just given her story. She would be referred to what's called Healthy Families Program, where someone comes into the home every week and assists her with appropriate child development, parenting education, helping the baby meet the developmental milestones, bonding and attachment between the baby and Florence, and do that kind of education. We are not hearing any of that. A lot of the situation that Florence is in could have been prevented and cost a lot less money and a lot less heartache if we had just addressed the issue from an educational perspective, doing prevention. Prevention, so that we do not have to do intervention, right? Because it is a lot easier to shape a child into a healthy adult than it is to change a broken adult into a healthy person. And we want to nip things in the bud, so to speak. And that's why we look at the policies and the programs that are impacting people like Florence. Any other questions, comments?
Mm-hmm. I was going to say transportation is one of the biggest issues in the rural areas. Mm-hmm. There's not usually a public transportation system, buses, and it's expensive to take cabs. And if you don't have family or community resources driving you to and from, then you're walking places. And if everything's far apart, then again, it's difficult to even utilize the resources that are available.
Everything is so spread out. Yeah, you're right. Transportation is such an issue. Are you getting that? Do you kind of get the idea of how we work with a person from the strengths perspective first and foremost? Then we look at the problems in these various areas: the micro, the meso, the micro, the meso, the macro. And with the problems that we identify, we flip it and turn it into an intervention, right? And that intervention is how we move to make positive change in a person's life. If a person comes into us feeling this low, we want them to leave feeling better. Life is working better for them, and they're achieving some goals that we've set up together in collaboration with the client.